True.
Film done, and we all most love of each the other time. Still.
Do I need it
to me? No, well, you figure you're very loud, so.
Okay, fine. That's good.
Jason's just overly loud.
I'm excessive.
They're not actually using you, they're just putting you in there so you feel part of the group.
We thought you would do the stunts. You would act out whatever happens in the conversation.
I'll twitch you.
We can give you a sample of how he was actually acting the creature.
Do people ask you to do that in the street? Is that?
Sometimes, in South Africa, sometimes.
And do you ever do it?
Yes.
Are you serious?
Well, they said make the sound. They did that on the radio, like make the sound.
But you didn't make the sound. In the
but he made the first sound.
No, but they like.
He did last night.
Make alien sound yeah. on the radio.
Yeah. So where did the alien sound come from?
A pumpkin. Multiple different pumpkins.
Dude, is that true? Because I thought he just told some guy
no,
that
they
story.
Were.
They were rubbing yeah. a pumpkin?
Jay simplified it a bit.
Sounds dirty.
Yeah.
So dirty.
It doesn't sound good. Were they New Zealanders? They must have been.
And they were New Zealanders.
Yes, they were.
It wasn't just a pumpkin, though. It was multiple vegetables. And yeah,
I didn't know that.
Try it. Go home and try.
They would get vibration like by rubbing certain things. It was
what?
Yeah, the clicking of the insects.
Why don't you just go?
And then what they do is they'd hold the edge and then move their hand and maximize the friction and go like.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then they digitize that.
Yeah.
Like.
So these are the highest end sound effects.
Yeah.
Ever. To man.
Dude, lots of them are made like that though. Star Wars. All of the vehicles in Star Wars are like home kitchen appliances. I mean, you know.
So you didn't have Deborah Winger doing E.T. It was
No.
It's very special. We started out having the conversation about which one of these guys was the bigger genius. So as the writing partner, how does that work? How were your writing sessions as you were developing this idea?
You know what? They were great because, I mean, we worked for, three, 4 months in the beginning. And I went, sure. No,
we were just talking earlier. He was asking which one of us was more talented. And I kept pushing myself.
Oh.
And
I kept pushing him as well.
Sharl wasn't pushing himself.
So am I answering the question incorrectly?
Your question is correct.
Oh.
Well, just be careful how you answer now, because you may regret it, is what he's saying.
What's the question? Who's the genius?
Is it always like this?
This was before. This was the.
Before you answer the question, is it always like this?
My question from me. Do they always bicker?
No, all four of you are having a party here.
Oh, do we all speak at once yet still hear each other?
In a loving way.
Yes.
In a loving way. No, the writing wasn't like that though. The writing actually worked. I would have thought it would have been like that, but it wasn't because I think that we both had different areas of expertise. Mm-hmm. That we brought to it, and we respected each other's areas.
It's a good matchup.
It was a very good matchup. There was very few things. I mean, and ultimately, if I felt something that and he didn't agree with it, then he was the director. So I didn't really kick my feet too much.
So even while writing, you respected that.
I did respect that. I always it was
the same with the prawn. You respect authority. So this is the guy who has the control. And then it's very clear. There's not confusion. It seems confusing to you, my friend, because you don't understand.
Use force.
But actually, there's a boss, this guy, and then the rest of us, we can be prawns because he says he decides. Then that word is final.
Very accurate.
We help facilitate his genius.
Very accurate description.
So was the storyline, the idea of the movie, kind of set when you guys started writing? Or
not at all. We hashed that out for a long time and played with it and changed it and worked within that world because there's so many things you could explore in that world. It's kind of fun almost to think of all the different things, but we had to nail it down. And once we decided that Vickis was going to change, then it just moved forward.
Yeah, Sharlto's character changing into the alien really was, it really was a different animal before that. Mm-hmm. And the moment that had been figured out in the writing, it was a different film. And it was what District 9 is now.
And did you?
That was that held it together.
And so you guys, you sound very American.
Canadian.
Okay, so you guys met in Canada, I guess?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm trying to bring it all together and try to figure out the pieces
of it.
And did Preeter and Fran say that you guys had to get together because that was just the way it works now for big action movies?
No.
You're required to be couples and...
It was a blind date.
Are you going to have a third friend who writes with you?
Yeah.
Pete said that he'd met this girl at the coffee store that he thought I should take on a date.
Yeah. She seemed like she had some good writing ideas.
And yeah, you should really listen to her.
Yeah.
No, like we were a couple, and we moved to New Zealand where I was going to direct Halo,
right?
And it collapsed. And then the next morning, when we were doing District 9, it was that I asked Pete and Fran if I was like, can Terri and I write it? And that we basically moved forward from there. So they were always aware of everything we were doing. We would write in our house down the streets, and we would go and have story meetings with them and show them everything we were doing. And we were all in communication with one another.
Does it feel like a village of, you know, artists down there when you're doing that kind of thing? I mean, it does seem like they're knocking out a lot of stuff down there these days. Mm.
Village? Yes. Yeah. It is totally Miramar is the suburb within Wellington where it all happens, and there is no question that that is the sort of Lord of the Rings family, and it's all about film.
Does getting away matter a lot, or you're away in South Africa already?
No, it's totally different to South Africa. It's like everybody that, it's like, you know how LA is a company town? Mm. Everybody seems to be working in the film industry, but in reality it's so big that that isn't really the case if you go to Safeway or you go to like the gas station or something. Wellington is different. Mm-hmm. It's like every person, like I would see you now when I went to Starbucks after this.
Right.
And we'd be like, oh, that's weird, I'm seeing you. And then I would see Jen 15 minutes later, and I'd see every single person everywhere in the city all the time. Mm-hmm. Because it's so small, but it's the same like volume of, you know, work that gets done.
So when the... You went back to South Africa to shoot?
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, all of the pre-production was New Zealand, and then the actual shooting was Joburg.
Okay, so you brought together a crew. We were talking before about the crew, you know, not being used to having this kind of budget for an action film, and how kind of exciting it was for
that people
working in
South
Africa.
Africans, you mean. Yeah, right, yeah, sure.
So did you come in with a, you know, okay, here, let's go and do this, or were you still worried about balancing out the budget and the size of the thing?
Well, I mean, it doesn't, even though South Africa may be cheaper to shoot in, and relatively speaking, it was more money than is usually spent there, it's still very low budget in comparison to big summer films.
Right.
And audiences don't care how much money you had. So if it's not on the screen, they don't care. Mm-hmm. So in order to get that Hollywood quality, most of the money had to go into the visual effects.
Right.
So yes, we had more money than was normally maybe spent in South Africa. I don't know if that's totally true, because they shoot big movies there as well.
But on the one hand, but the big thing that was different about it is that it's a South African action movie.
Sure, that okay, that's true. Yeah. We're making a local film.
Yeah, that is actually set in South Africa, about South Africa. It's not cheating to be somewhere else. Yeah. Jason, that was the interesting thing about the whole with all of us, is that Jason used to work for one of my companies. And Jason was actually the production manager on Alive in Joburg, which was the original. That's kind of where Neil met him. And Jason was also on camera in Alive in Joburg, played like the United Nations guy. Mm-hmm. So just kind of a weird... So Jason was also, although he was acting more than I was, he was actually pursuing it sort of kind of part-time. But he was also a guy working behind the scenes with me.
So do most of the South Africans who want to work in this business have to kind of... have four different skill sets at the same time to survive?
I'd say you probably do, although I think it's a certain type of person that tends to want to do that if you can. The industry is very developed there, so the guys at the top of their game are generally, you know, they pretty much, they'll compete with anyone anywhere else, and they're very specialized in their different departments.
We've got a very strong service industry, so the guys, you'll have a grip that is an amazing grip, and he's just a grip, and that's all he does. But you do also get people that multitask a lot. And it just depends.
Mm. And did you crew up with people that you had worked with before in commercials, or?
I had a lot of people in different departments that I had worked with before, but in specifically shooting the film, Trent Opelock, who's the DP of the film, is like an age-old kind of friend of mine, and we've done lots and lots of work together in Canada, and he came to South Africa with me. Mm-hmm. And then Shaul, who was acting in the movie, and Jay, who I knew. But I mean, it was pretty limited, actually. On South African soil, most of the crew were people that I met for the first time doing the actual production. But
who were South Africans?
Yeah, who were South Africans. Because I've never really shot in South Africa before. I've shot Alive in Joburg there, but it was these two guys put that together. Mm-hmm. So the bigger stuff that I had shot before is all Canadian or American.
So when the script started kind of getting around to actors and to people in the crew and so forth in South Africa, was the reaction, oh my God, this is going to happen? Were you guys blown away before you even made it?
The first thing that I felt, can I just say, because I remember that reading the first draft, was the excitement of the, oh my God, because it was just so action-packed, and it starts off and you're like, okay, cool, like I mentioned, but we work on a lot of quite calm movies in South Africa, and then to some point the script's went, doof, and it went like crazy, and then you'd say things like, then follows 15-minute battle with... blah, blah, blah. And I'd just be like, oh my God, this is going to be so cool. And then the excitement of that. And then the other actors were all totally like, my God, we're just going to shoot guns and fly helicopters. And everybody was, you know, for us it was a big thing as well to make an action movie. So it was very exciting.
And yet it's not just a boom, boom, bang, bang movie. It does exactly. have a big heart that seems to be...
Yeah, when I mean, for me, just to see the reaction of the South African crew to the character, I felt pretty good about how South African audiences would respond to it. Because throughout the making of the film, the crew were responding a lot to the character, which was encouraging at the time.
And what has been the response in South Africa?
It's been good.
It's been crazy. It's really, it's kind of, they've really embraced the film. And it, to be honest, I mean, it could have gone either way. Just South Africa's weird like that. They sort of, you know, if somebody does really well, they can kind of try and sort of pull you down. Or, mm-hmm. But it's, South Africa really just jumped behind the film. They've jumped behind the character and they you know, launched websites all over the place.
I think the thing that's different about it is that it's kind of what Jay was saying earlier, is that South Africans don't really, they service other people's films, I suppose. Mm-hmm. So if you have homegrown South African films, they tend to be, rightfully so, movies that are total bleeding heart films about a very serious background that the country's had. That's what they tend to be. So there's like a validation. There's kind of this thing about entering Hollywood and like entering, you know, the entertainment world as South Africa, which hasn't really ever happened before.
Yeah.
And that's what they're latching onto, which is very cool, because then it's like now it's an international film and people around the world have seen it and they've seen Joburg, and you know, people living in shacks in Soweto say that this international film was shot in their backyard. So there's a huge amount of sort of validation in that.
Do they see it as political there at all?
I think so. I mean, these guys know better than me, but...
Not really. I mean, because it's so South African, everything that you see in there...
Everything is political in South Africa.
People can relate to it, so it's quite... People laugh a lot in the cinemas there. There's a lot of laughter, and it's quite an emotional experience because you see all of the sort of dark side of yourself and all the stereotypes that we deal with every day put up onto the screen, and but made into like a cool action movie format, and I think people actually just love that because it sort of validates who you are, and you can kind of put yourself up there as a South African, you put yourself up there on the screen, and watch this action movie at the same time. So people just love it.
We kind of thought there would be like a tagline of, you know, finally somebody for black people to hate too. You can share your bigotry together. Has that evolved in South Africa? I mean, is that this is completely off the movie a little bit, but is it now that there is a more of a balance? Has racism in the reverse ways and kind of odd sideways happened?
South Africa is a very complex country. You know, if you start talking about that type of issue, you need a very long time to have that conversation.
I think what is fair to say is that in a nutshell, it is slowly becoming more about the haves and the have-nots.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
And that it's obviously still about race, but to a lesser degree. It's more about money and people that don't have money. And like, so almost like Brazil, really, or the rest of the world. And I think that's happening now. Yeah. So race is, it's getting a bit more muddy with race, a little bit more blurry, and it's about money and no money.
But South Africa is changing very far, like from the South Africa that I remember from 10 years ago, especially in the big city, Johannesburg, and what's happening at all echelons of societies. It's transforming at an almost sort of unbelievable pace. But it depends where you are. So it is very mixed, but largely very positive. I mean, we've got a very fast-growing middle class, and it's, it moves fast. Things move very fast in South Africa.
So as a Canadian, did you have to familiarize yourself with South Africa?
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, I was already fairly...
We'd gone there.
I mean, I'd been there quite a few times, and I'd taken the tour of Soweto, and I'd been to the Apartheid Museum.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, I felt like to do the film justice, I needed to sort of immerse myself in it in a different way. And it's funny, the things that I maybe thought were quite dark before, I actually was able to see a lot of beauty and happiness there where I hadn't, which was, I mean, I feel very privileged that I was able to have Johannesburg as the backdrop to create a story, because it's a very special place.
And is beauty and happiness your strength of the writing team? Is that what you brought? Is that what's different about you? Or
no, I think her strength is kind of like structure, really, and kind of making it be a cohesive story, gelling it all together.
It's a very tight movie.
Yeah.
It's one of the things that I think people like, you know, don't expect necessarily, because they're used to action movies being, you know, oh look, that bomb went off, and you know that's what you went for. You went for that 30 seconds of something exploding. But this
very
movie
important
actually
also that the character doesn't look at the explosion when the when the explosion goes off. They must walk away from it with the explosion behind them, so
and not flinch.
Yeah, it's like, yeah,
if they're
don't
the good
flinch
character,
and don't look back.
Is that the first rule of screenwriting action movies?
Yeah.
You know what's interesting about that is, like Neil was just saying the other day, he was talking about it from a point of view from a writing point of view, the basic fundamental thing that they always talk about is put your character in trouble and put your, it's conflict, put as much conflict in there as you can. But it so rarely happens that writers actually take a character. This is what I got so ecstatic about when Neil first told me what the idea was going to be, was this is going to take a character and just keep upping the ante on what's happening to him, not only externally, because that's what Hollywood does really well. Now there's another whole set of tanks. Now you're stuck in the building. Oh, how are you going to get past the fighter jet? Oh, you got past the fighter jet. How do you get past the Megatron Galopalon? You know, are you going to make it?
Right.
It's an external problem. The real stuff audiences can really relate to at a conflict level is what's actually going on inside the person. So with Vickers, he's conflicted in himself as well as externally, and that to me was the exciting thing from a performance point of view, to be able to sink my teeth into that character. I knew it could be very emotionally engaging because of that.
Well, it does. It seems like an early 70s movie. In many ways, I keep comparing it to the Defiant ones. That's, you know, the Defiant ones with an alien instead of a black guy, and they're kind of stuck together. But it is that kind of, you know, it feels like a message movie. But then you came up with these great explosions.
I think we both kind of we both sort of agreed like pretty early on, and you know that I was saying it in there as well, that the first place that I went to was something that was a little bit too serious because of the amount of what the subject matter is, and I really don't think that films change people or society at all. I think people put a lot of value in films that actually they don't really deserve. So if you think you're really important and you want to change the world, you probably shouldn't be a filmmaker. They're about entertainment ultimately. And so it's exactly what you said. There's a bunch of interesting, important topics, but really it's entertainment. And the part that is entertainment, or the part that will keep people entertained, is if they can understand what the lead character is going through on a pure emotional level, like simple as that. So, and that's what it's about, really. I mean, what he goes through is a transformation that plays on the idea of race. But ultimately, everyone in the theater can understand, or could put themselves in his shoes and go along for that ride.
But there's something exciting about getting a 14-year-old to actually even think about that.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I mean, I think about that stuff all the time. That's why I made the film. But my personal opinion is that I don't think films change that much. I really don't. I think filmmakers like to think that they are really, you know, important. But I'm not sure about that.
But it was a cool story, like in that way, because when South Africans watch it, they love the action stuff because they already know everything else. They know all of the important messages, and they latch onto the action stuff. So it takes all of that heaviness and goes, it's okay.
Or the comedy,
It takes all of that heaviness and it goes, let's just make an action movie out of it. And then somebody else who's used to watching action movies that doesn't know South Africa, they'll notice the stuff that's new for them, which is the messages inside. And then they'll
the
be
subtlety.
Like, well, yeah. So you can look at it from two different sides, the film.
So did you consult with Clint Eastwood to show him how to add more weapons to Invictus?
That's a very interesting idea, yeah.
Have you seen Invictus, the comp they did with Vickers?
No, I haven't.
They've done a rip-off of the Invictus poster, Invictus, and it's like, his people needed hope. He gave them sweeties. It's like me in the front.
That's awesome. You know you've
it's
made
very
it,
funny. There's a lot of that going on in South Africa.
So are you ready to blow up stuff for Michael Bay? Is that where we're heading next with you?
Hey man, I love some of Michael Bay's movies, you know. Transformers 2 I'm not so sure about, but a lot of his other films were a lot of fun.
I'm a massive Michael Bay fan as well.
So you're willing to go for the candy? You like the candy sometimes?
To watch it, you mean?
Yeah.
Or to direct it? I really do dig Michael Bay. Like Transformers 2, also like Shaw, wasn't my favorite, but he's such a good action director.
Yeah.
Like, and I like how just ridiculously theatrical, like the action mixed with his kind of Hans Zimmer usually or Jablonski scores. They hype you up.
Yeah. No, he's brilliant. That's the thing that's funny about it. He's so good and yet so evil on some level.
Yeah.
So he has good. No interest
so,
in
like cheesy. Yeah.
Soulless.
Yeah.
But brilliant.
Yeah.
I mean, and I don't think he's that as a human being, but I do think he is. You know, for some reason, doesn't really care to go.
Yeah.
Too much deeper.
Yeah.
So you want to? So, but I mean, are you ready to sell out to Hollywood? Is that you? Are you ready to go there? Or you want
I can only play characters that I can resonate with. It's not something that I can kind of do half. So I would love to say that theoretically, if you offered me a certain amount of money, I would take it because I'm mostly a business guy for most of my life.
Right.
but I just wouldn't be able to actually do it. So I can only play, it's not really the film or the director or the whatever, it's like to read the script and look at the character and go, yes, I can totally nail this character or not. And from an acting point of view, that's really it for me. And I like to do stuff that is, that potentially would have a commercial appeal. I have a very commercial taste in movies. I'm not really an art movie kind of guy. I like commercial films. So, but as an actor, I like roles that are more interesting than what, than most of what I see.
He wants to replace Martin Lawrence in Bad Boys 3.
He'd be good with Will Smith. Yeah. They'd be a good team together. We were talking a little bit before we started doing the screening about the reaction to the movie and how it's affected your guys' lives. Mm. Was it overnight for you guys as well? Was it kind of like
for us?
Wham? For you guys, for was there an immediate sense of, oh my God, we've gotten ourselves into this?
Well, for me at first, it was just unreality. I was like, it was like reading April, when you read the April Fool's things, you're like, that's an April Fool's one. And I read the first number one in America, because I was in South Africa at the time, and they were doing like the South African version of the publicity tour, which is like a guy phones you once a week. And then he says, hey, the film, when is it? I'll phone you tomorrow, whatever. And then they'll phone you. And then, so it was, everything was normal, everything was still fine. And then right. Suddenly you looked on it, and then the amount of Google hits that started going for District 9 started going, like the counter started going up. And I couldn't process it at first. And it was actually quite stressful in the beginning, because I was like, what, you know, you had to suddenly adapt your mind to understanding what the movie was that you were making. Because we, like, I don't know about you, but when we were making it, we were just focused on the movie. Mm. And mm-hmm. you didn't think about the future. Mm-hmm.
And, that's true.
But then after that, it was exciting.
And for you guys, was Comic-Con the first hint of just how big this thing could be, or?
Comic-Con was definitely, yeah, there's no question. I wouldn't say that it was the first hint as to how big it could be, but it was the first hint ever that anybody other than like four people liked it.
That's true.
So, and that was a big deal.
Yeah. So you hadn't done test screenings
and
all that stuff?
Nothing. And we kind of, you know, we got on the plane and went to San Diego, and I literally didn't know how it was going to go. I always felt like I had made a film that I felt proud of, which is cool. I always felt like I had made something that I wanted to watch, which is, mm-hmm. you know, the kind of the barometer that you sort of test it by. So I felt good about it. It was just a case of like, was it just going to be a few diehard fans? Mm-hmm. Or would more people like it? And so Comic-Con was a really big deal because the audience really liked it.
And Peter actually choosing to come to Comic-Con for the first time was kind of a big
deal.
Yeah,
which was awesome. Yeah.
That's a pretty good sign of support
for
the picture.
Yeah.
So did you stay in the room when that first screening happened?
Yeah, we watched the whole thing.
That was the first time I watched the whole thing. Yeah.
And
so that was the overnight thing for me, was going into the Comic-Con day. Up until then, I mean, from 2005, I sort of knew the world that he was making, and the acting in it and everything was all fine, and just nothing really changed at all. And then that day at Comic-Con, everything went crazy.
Could you even hear the reaction for staring at the movie?
The film, you know, if you've seen the film, it's really full on. It motors at you. It's very fast. There's a hell of a lot of things going on. I'm in the film, and it took me two or three watches of it to actually see what was in, what wasn't, to pick up things that I missed on the, and that first time was really so overwhelming. I mean, it was the first time I'm watching it. I'm watching it with Neill and 400 other people that are going to go onto the web afterwards and say exactly what they think.
I was there.
I don't even know if they understand my accent as the character. Suddenly, I'm not as gung-ho as I was before, saying, no, they'll understand it. I'm like, imagine they get to the end and everyone just goes, we can't understand the English. We don't understand. That was the thought that was in my mind. Yeah. It's Peter Jackson, like you say, and it was very surreal. It became real when we were being ushered. Remember, we were being ushered through the kitchens and stuff at the hotel with Peter Jackson and security. And we go into the basement, and there's just this rack of black SUVs with doors open. It was like, what is this, the CIA? What is this? Like, what is happening?
And has it been like that since? Because you have not been here for
pretty much
a lot of the every day is like that.
Yeah, well, I mean, just for me, the reality thing.
Sean only flies
that,
in his
Gulfstream. That the reality is weird. That things just keep changing. You know, I was on the publicity tour, then I didn't go home. I went to go do A-Team because I got that, and it just keeps going. You know, and then it's like, hello, Mr. Liam Neeson. Hi, how are you? You know, it's a very surreal thing, is what I'm saying.
And how was that experience? How has that experience been different than shooting with this guy?
Oh, it's totally different. It's a totally, totally different process. And I mean, I could talk for hours on that, but it's Neill is a kind of a creative commercial artist, I would always say, I'd almost say. And that's a very different way. The way that him and Peter were able to make the film is obviously dramatically different from how studios go about making films.
But Face just came easily to you? You saw that?
Script? I'm doing Murdoch.
I'm sorry.
Murdoch. Yeah, yeah. I'm flattered that you say Face. I am quite flattered about that. That's, hey, isn't that pretty sweet? Hey, Bradley, what do you think of that? Him and I, Murdoch's got this competition with Face on the A-team. No,
did you guys, I assume you had the A-team in South Africa?
Yes, it was my favorite show as a kid.
Was it really your favorite show? And was it around the same time as the U.S.? Because I remember the Super Bowl screening of it.
And yeah.
It was like a big deal when it came out.
Yeah.
When we started marketing character. District 9,
yeah,
like off the Comic-Con, then he said that he may be up for A-Team, which I thought was hilarious. And then he sent me this photo. He's like, dude, I think I'm going to get it because of this. And so he sends me this photo. And he's like six. I don't know how old he is.
He's 11.
He's 11.
Jeez.
And he's standing over his birthday cake, which is like Mr. T on his birthday cake.
With the old South African flag as well. So like in 1985 really? In South Africa, you could walk into a shop and buy a cake with a black hero on it, no problem.
And have you met Mr. T yet?
I haven't actually. I hope I do.
He hasn't been on the set the whole time?
No. Dwight Schultz has, the guy who plays Murdoch.
Dude, why isn't he? That's a good question about why.
There's a lot of conversation. I'm pushing them to try and get as many cameos as possible.
He was in a Sony movie this summer.
Really?
He was in Cloudy with a Side of Meatballs. I thought you might actually like this. I give this to you. When they're on camera, you just have to push the thing.
I push it? What do I push?
Push it on the.
Oh, just here?
In the glass, wherever?
Oh, no, I just pressed the wrong thing.
Turn it off.
Play.
Yeah, is it sound on?
He's South African. The
I'm South African. We don't have those.
Yeah, there we go.
This is a complicated gadget, eh? It's a fancy thing.
Just push the glass, like push his face.
That's very cool. I want this for Rampage.
It's an animated, his mouth moves a little, and every phrase that Mr. T ever said is all.
That's hilarious.
You need that.
You always need to have that nearby.
You can't drive, sucker!
You could have been playing him. You could have been playing BA.
Yeah.
So is there a sense of completion at this point, or you guys feel like there's still the award seasons and all that, or are you...
I felt like it was completed before this award season thing.
Yeah, I thought it was done, to be honest. I thought it was over.
I guess it's not.
Hey, Jen, good to see you again. How long does it go on for? It's like... Just as this is done, it's like sequel time.
Yeah.
Like, okay, just for a moment, let's do something else.
We've gotten ourselves into
District 10, is it coming? Have you guys written it yet?
We haven't written it, no. She's writing a different film, and I'm writing my new film that I'm doing. So I'm doing something for the next 2 years. But I all of us want to go back to the world of District 9. Huh. It's just we all have something else sort of between now and then.
So did you figure out why you want to go back to District 9?
Well, it goes, I mean, obviously, what you're saying basically is there a story worth telling?
No, I'm asking what it is that it inspired, you know, when you say you all want something back there.
Mm-hmm. I think each of us have different reasons. I mean, for me, there isn't a story at the moment,
right.
But I can tell that there is so much to be explored in that world, especially from me as a director. Like, I want to go and direct films in that world over and over. Mm-hmm. Like, Aliens in South Africa is very compelling to me. And that's my reason, and everybody, I'm sure, has different reasons for it.
Yeah, I would just have, it's about as creatively rewarding a process as I've ever done in my life, to be honest. And the fact that it did commercially well has just been a fantastic bonus. So if we could do more of it, it's got so much, the world that Neill and Terri have created has got so much of the kind of emotions that I've experienced growing up in South Africa, the ironies, the layered, you know, it's not a nice, simple morality tale that just wraps everything up at the end. These things are complicated. They're multi-layered. They you know, insights into the human condition, into how we separate ourselves from everything, actually. Rather, you know, it goes way deeper than just race.
Do you want to write more?
Yeah, I think that thing when I think about going back to it, what excites me are all those little stories and little things that we had to leave behind that still feel real to me. And if there's a way to bring them back and incorporate them into the next one, then that.
It's also the kind of, the way I see it in my head is it is a lot like Star Wars in that just from a pure science fiction kind of standpoint, I want to know, like if you go into some random alien shack, I know there's some shack that you can go into where there's some kind of machine that looks like it you know, can manufacture the craziest thing you can imagine. I know that's in there somewhere. I know in some other shack there's a tunnel that goes down like 600 meters to God knows what, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's like, I want to know what's in all of those shacks. Like, I want to know what they're up to. I want to know what's on the ship. You know, so that's the reason I want to go back there, because it's such a weird mixture of like science fiction fun and you can touch on political stuff.
And there's also the money we could make.
There is the money, yes.
Can you imagine?
I mean, you could ask for an enormous sum.
We should really make it for money. That's the main.
You could buy yourself a plane.
We should tell Sony that. Yeah.
We will do it for a plane.
But can you imagine yourself going back and doing like all the things that George Lucas has done with comic books
exactly.
and cartoon series? Yeah. And is that the kind of layering that you can imagine?
Well, I'm not sure. That would be really cool. I'm just not sure that it's that. I mean, Star Wars is Star Wars. You know, you can't really beat Star Wars. But I know that there's definitely another few films that have me captivated. Like, I want to go and explore that world.
And you really want to put on the suit again?
Yeah, I love the leotard. So, no, I love my favorite thing.
We should get it modified this time, eh?
What, make
like
it tighter?
Like, put some, sort of like a pants on it or something.
Yeah, let's not talk about the leotard. My favorite thing was just making it with all of these South African filmmakers. Now, we all made it together. There was this big sort of dream come true for all of us, for like the runners and the art department and everyone. We got to build spaceships and crash them into Joburg and do all of the stuff that you normally, it seems that you're not allowed to do. Like, the rule book of South African filmmaking is no spaceships, no laser guns,
no
bullets. That's too many bullets. Yeah. 4 bullets is enough. You know, 4 bullets. And then there's this rule book that everybody sort of follows. And then Neill just went, threw it out the window. And we're like, wow, this is great. So, and the excitement of making that with all of the people there and all of the crew and the art department, that was my favorite thing. This like sort of collective buzz of like, wow, this is great.
I think part of the excitement for the audience is that they got to discover something or feel like they were discovering it, and not just, you know, have it marketed down their throats like so many things that are processed every year. Some of them by Michael Bay, some of them not.
Right.
But I mean, I think that was the thing. It's
interesting marketing.
It felt very personal.
Yeah. Mm.
And then when they got to the movie, they found something they didn't expect, and I think that made it even more compelling.
Yeah.
To go back and back again.
Yeah. I think part of that, I mean, Mark Weinstock and the guys at Sony that did that marketing, which I think was really good, and they seriously just got to the essence of the film. I think that, I've never really asked them about this, but I'm assuming that the fact that the film is relatively inexpensive allows the marketing to be a little bit more risky, and that's appealing. You know, like, it's not only that if the film is lower budget, I get to do what I want, which I do.
Right.
It's that the way that you can market it to fans doesn't mean that it has to be generic kind of stuff that's rammed down their throats. It's you can be a little bit more sort of risky about how you go about.
You don't have to put all the best stuff in the trailer,
and they can discover it. You know, like online, and which is how I want to see stuff. I don't like feeling like, you know, General Electric is selling me some piece of entertainment.